Thank you for coming. Now let's sing Burn in Me. Let the fire of the can stand after we've stood up. I'm going to sing, "Here I Am to Worship."
Angels.
Wonderful God. Hallelujah. Let's pray for our leaders this morning. Amen. Pastor Mitchell, Pastor Greg in Prescott, Arizona. Pastor Jesse and Diego Galvan as assisting there. Let's also lift up the East Coast. Paul Linda Campbell, Chip and Lori Ganier. Amen. And all that God is doing on the Cape. Hallelujah. Dave Suspansky and Wayne King in Jacksonville, North Carolina. Let's also remember my pastor, Pastor Keith, and his wife, Carrie Sullivan, for other sacrifice and labors and all the work that's going on in East Rochester. Every new convert there to make good decisions, to make good choices, the altars to be filled in their service this morning. Amen. Perhaps you've come with your own need that I did not mention, and I'd like you to lift your hand, amen, as a sign to God that you're going to ask out. You have not because you ask not, James says. So we're going to all agree together in prayer. God sees your hand, amen. And if you're online, we want to knit our hearts with yours too. Because, amen, God sees your issues in your life, what's happening with you. Let's pray also for families added to this church, raw conversions, visitors every week, and the Greece Church to become self-supporting financially. Amen. Let's go ahead and open up in prayer. Sora Van Epps, can you please do the honor? Amen.
God, I thank you for miracles, Lord God, what you're going to accomplish, God. We can't do anything without you. You're in control, Lord God. You're the God of the heavens and the earth. God, everything is at your disposal.
Direct him, Jesus.
Now, we're expecting great things from you, Lord God, for your glory. We
God,
believe
we
your miraculous
is
supernatural. I speak against enemies, powers, principalities, and rulers of darkness right now. We take authority over these things, these enemies of the cross. Every
fall.
I pray for those sick with COVID-19. I'm asking you to heal those, God, those who are sick, Lord God. Give them a miracle, God, and those who are grieving.
Lord God, I thank you for your spirit. God, I thank you for, God, your ever-present, God, the Holy Spirit that is in each and every one of us inside this building, God, that is inside your, God, sanctuary, that we can call out to you, God, and you can answer us, God, and that you can provide for us. We thank you, God, that you are a good God, that you are a forgiving God. We pray that you can give us, God, vision. You can give us an expectation for the future, God. And we can see Greece, God, rise up. We can see this church be filled and people fill each one of these seats, God. We pray for those unspoken requests, God. We pray against infirmity, God, addiction, God, and against doubt, God, that you give us a confidence, God, that you give us miracles and you give us healing in Jesus' name.
Amen. Let's give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Shed it up. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's take a minute to greet one another, make everybody feel welcome. Amen. It's glorious to be in the house of God. We want to thank everybody for coming this morning. Then a few announcements for the local congregation. And we're going to be back in church this night at 5:30 for prayer and 6:30 for our evening Sunday service. Amen. We'll be back on Wednesday night at 7:30 for worship, preaching, and glorifying God. Amen. Midweek service is always very helpful.
and that has a prayer service at 6:30. Amen. Take note of that. This Saturday we'll be outreaching once again for Greece and going door to door or going down to the beach to pray with people. Let's also remember that on Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, we have our adult Sunday school, and at 10:30 we have our worship service. Amen. Let's go ahead and believe God for miracles, conversions, lives being changed. If you've joined us online, we're located behind Buffalo Wild Wings. Amen. And you're more than welcome to come see what God is doing here. Hallelujah. We have a great event to end the summer. On the 15th of August, we're going to be having some bands play in the parking lot. We're going to be having food and some fun and outreach all day for Jesus. Starting at 11 o'clock in the morning, we're going to be going all day. The event will go from 5 to 7 if you'd like to join us for that. We would greatly appreciate it. If you have any abilities or talents or skills that you want to offer for the event, let us know how you can contribute, and God will richly bless you. Amen. I'd like to give a testimony about yesterday's outreach. We went door-to-door. We went down here, Hampton, by Letta, and wherever we were, almost to the expressway there, the parkway. And we went door to door and started telling people about Jesus, inviting people, handing out tracts, and watching what God would do. The last portion of the outreach, I ran into a young 16-year-old who was looking for his dog that was lost. What was the name of it? Shih Tzu. Can I say that in church? It was a strange breed of dog. But anyways, I got a chance to witness to him, to minister to him. He said he'd been going to church with his grandma. Go figure. To the Catholic Church. Didn't know anything about salvation or being born again. We prayed a sinner's prayer. He was very thankful and gracious to believe God together with me. Amen. Let's thank God for that young man praying on that day. Amen. Fruit into his life. Let his life change. God, heal his broken heart. Amen. Thank God for outreach and evangelism. Let's change the order of our service, and we're going to take up our morning offering. And this is from the book of Luke, chapter 8, verses 1 through 3. This is called Many Women Minister to Jesus. Now it came to pass afterward that Jesus went through every city and village preaching and bringing glad tidings of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him, and certain women who had been healed of evil spirits and infirmities. Mary called Magdalene, out of whom had come seven demons, and Johanna, the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others who provided for him from their substance. So we learn from our scripture here that many people were following Jesus, and they were paying their money out of their own substance. Perhaps they gave food, they gave victuals, they gave the things that were needed for his life as he was preaching and ministering throughout Galilee and Palestine. And we want you to know that we too have an opportunity, amen, to be generous with our things, our money, our finances, and we can contribute to the gospel that it can be ministered. Amen. When you're giving online, if you want to click the link, you can, hallelujah, make your offering, your tithes and offerings or pledges or any kind of money that God is beginning to deal with you about giving. You can pledge online with a credit card or a debit card, and God will richly bless you because God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. And when Jesus was provided for, he was liberated to focus on ministering and healing the sick and preaching. And you can think about that in this way: to minister to this church, you can help this church to continue in the vision of our fellowship, that is to preach and to win souls to Christ. We can pay for our building. We can become self-supporting, amen, as we will all get on board and contribute together. Can I have the usher come forward? Amen. Hallelujah. The tithe is holy and offerings besides. Brother Sawyer, can you pray over the offering this morning, please?
God, we know that you can deal with money that we cannot, but you can multiply it where we can only subtract. God, bless the gift and giver and all of their offerings besides.
Amen. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your offering.
It's like the Lord. There is no
songs and worshiping and making him magnified. Amen. If you brought your Bibles, you can turn with us to the book of Samuel. 1 Samuel 2, verse 30, in a moment. Amen. I want to thank everybody for laboring here with us on the platform. The songs leader and sister who's working the electronics and the computer, the laptop, amen. We greatly appreciate your service. And all those who are faithful to come to church, amen. I pray the Lord will richly bless you this morning. This is entitled, God Honors Those Who Honor Him. 1 Samuel 2, verse 30. Therefore, the Lord God of Israel says, I say that your house and the house of your father would forever walk before me. But now the Lord says, far be it from me, for those who honor me, I will honor, and those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed. Amen. We're going to look into the story of our sister Hannah, who was barren, and in the days of the Bible, barrenness was a curse because everybody wanted to have a family. Every woman wanted to have children. And when you could not produce them, there was a great darkness over your life, over your husband, and over your family because you could not have kids. We're going to learn in our scripture that barrenness can be broken. And the fruit of breaking barrenness is giving life. And we'll find that Hannah actually did have a baby and named him Samuel. Secondly, we're going to learn that being honored by God is everything. The whole world can come against you and reject you and laugh at you. But amen, when you have God on your side, who can be against us? God wants to honor you this morning. Amen. In our scripture, we find that Hannah is grieving because she can't have children. Specifically, she wants a son. Verse 10, she was in bitterness of soul. And she prayed to the Lord and wept in anguish. Anguish, or great sorrow came upon her. Honor is a transitive verb in regard to treat someone with admiration and respect. To regard or to treat with honor is to honor someone. To give special recognition to or confer honor upon, to live up to or fulfill the terms of honor or a commitment. Amen. Honoring God. We need to look first at our need, and that is to honor God. Respecting Him, revering Him. Amen. Scripture says that when we sing songs to Him, that He inhabits the praise of His people. God actually comes down in the service, and we can give Him what He truly deserves. We can sing songs to Him. We can pay our tithes. We can give money. We can give attention with our ears, amen, as we're listening to God's word. That's respecting Him and giving Him what He deserves. Our lives need to be laid down firstly. To honor God means we are no longer living for ourselves in our selfish and selfish vices and just pursuing happiness, whatever it takes. Many times we are way too concerned with me all the time. We need to pursue His will. Firstly, lay down our lives. Secondly, pursue Him. And thirdly, to worship Him. Praising God is not just singing and lifting hands. That's good. Raising your arms and in a worship service. That's what many people think of when they hear the word worship. But, you know, going all the way and surrendering everything in your life, whether it's singing or your own honor or your own pride, to maybe sing these songs or, you know, to worship and lift your hands, but also to make God a prize in your heart. That's what praise really means. When you prize God, when you treasure God, when you consider Him to be everything in your life of great value, that is praising God. We need to be honoring God through praising Him. Fourthly, we need to be fulfilling our vows to Him. We honor God by fulfilling our part of the bargain. Follow through means we honor God. When you got saved, you said, I'm not going to live that way anymore. And when you stopped living in sin, amen, and stopped pursuing those things, you began to honor God. When you came to the altar and you got saved, or maybe you came to the altar and you just dedicated something to God, you said, God, I'm sick of doing this. I know You do not like this. I want You to take it from me. And you made a vow to God. You said, if You could do this for me, man, I'm going to serve You. And God heard your vow. He heard what you promised. And He's a faithful God. Now it's our need to fulfill that vow and follow through and make that happen. We become faithful to the work in the fields as sons. The parable of two sons, Matthew 21, reads like this. In verse 28, but what do you think? A man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, son, go to the work in the fields today. And he answered and said, I will. But he never did. He regretted it and went. Then, as he came to the second, he said, likewise. And he answered and said, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of the Father? And they answered, Jesus. He said, the first. Following through with what you say you're going to do is a great need in our lives to honor God. Good intentions are not enough. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, good meanings. You have moments of emotional conviction where you want to go to church, and then when it finally comes time to it, you say, no, I'm not going for whatever reason. Or you wanted to do something, you wanted to give money to the church. You said, I'm going to give this, and then you never gave it. We have to follow through with our vows to Him. Secondly, we as servants of the Most High God. Luke 12, 43. Blessed is that servant when his master will find him doing so when he returns. Amen. Serving God is a great job, a great responsibility. And following through with what God wants us to do, whether it's working in a certain agenda or a certain field or a certain way of doing something. Amen. We need to be serving Him and serving other people. Literally, God, doing something for God instead of just talking about it. Much of the church world loves to talk about evangelism, but they're not doing it. Many people call them themselves Pentecostal, but they don't speak in tongues. Many people are called to do great things, but they say they want to do that, but they back off and they don't follow through with what they truly believe or what they discover Scripture says is important to do. Fifthly, our last need in this realm is to die. Dying to ourselves brings honor to God. When we die to ourselves, our flesh and the devil will not have the honor. You give honor to the devil when you go out and sin. You give honor to yourself and your flesh when you're concerned with your own things. But when you die to yourself, you give honor to God. You make God alive in your life.
Amen.
You give Him right away. We need to die. We need to serve God as a grain of wheat. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone, Jesus taught. But if it dies, it brings forth much fruit. We need to die. John 12:26, if anyone serves me, then follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. And if anyone serves me, my Father will honor him. Secondly, in the realm of needs, we need to remain faithful. We're going to get into our scripture very quickly, but Hannah believed God, and we're going to see the scriptures are going to teach us that although she was had that curse in her life and barren and not fruitful, unable to have children, she remained faithful. It's a cakewalk when everything is going your way. You don't have any problems. You have money in the bank. You have a great job, a career. Finances are in order. Your body is healthy. Your marriage is solid. But what do you do when you have no apparent fruit? Do we still honor God when we don't see His promises ordained? Maybe He forgot what He told us He was going to do. We think God is senile. He forgets, you know, that promise He gave you. Then we question His integrity. If He changes His mind, why would He do that to us? And when we think this way erroneously about God's character, we put ourselves in great danger of losing our relationship with Him. We don't see any apparent fruit, but we still need to remain faithful. We always need to trust God completely. This is the hardest thing to do, because we don't see things materializing. They don't appear as quickly or the way God, we thought the way God was going to bring it to pass. What we imagined in that time when we were like getting inspired, God's going to do something this way. It never usually happens that way. And thirdly, to remain faithful, we need to walk by faith. And that is to not trust in our environment, trust in our senses, not by sight, not by just what we hear say. This involves removing ourselves from this reality into God's reality, which is really more tangible and eternal. It's more of a realm of substance than this feeling that we have now in this world. Because this world is only temporary. The feelings are fleeting. It's only based on emotion, and therefore it's very dangerous. You can't build your life on it. You have to walk by faith. Sometimes life just doesn't make sense. And God brings to me meaning, amen, brings meaning to the sorrow and the pain that we are suffering, because joy comes in the morning. It comes at a later time. We need to keep walking by faith. Jesus promised that he was going to heal the brokenhearted. That was his ministry. Amen. He will do it. Barrenness will be broken in your life. We can read in Joel 2:25. He restores the years which the locusts have eaten. Amen. The seemingly wasted years and years of struggle and pain and disobedience. Amen. God will bring all of that around in a moment's time. Amen. And bring fruit into your life. John 15:16. You did not choose me. I chose you to go and bear fruit. I have ordained you to bear fruit. Amen. Let's look at the lightly esteemed. Those who do not honor God will also be lightly esteemed. These are people who don't honor God. They dishonor him. And those who despise me shall be lightly esteemed, Scripture says. Firstly, despising the things of God will bring a curse upon your life. Secondly, not paying your tithes dishonors God. And thirdly, Proverbs 3, verse 9, honor the Lord with your possessions and the first fruits of all your increase. Fourthly, the Christian who doesn't honor God will be lightly esteemed. Their testimony has no power or anointing. It is without force. There's nothing really behind it. It's only a religious testimony. And people can see it too. When you're not really devoted to God, and you're just playing religion like the Pharisees. There's no power in that. There's no power in your life. Amen. You will become lightly esteemed by God and by people around you. So let's secondly look at the promises we find in Scriptures about honoring God, even in adversity, even when others shame you. There's no fruit. Do you choose to honor God when nothing is going on? You're not seeing any results. You're missing the success. The promise has not been fulfilled. God in times past has spoken to you specifically about your future success, but he never gave you a timeline. He didn't say it was going to happen on June 5th, 2015. He didn't give you a date for it. Think about Abraham. He was finally 100 years old when he had his Isaac. And his wife was 90. For some of you, you're still waiting. You're waiting for God to bring it to pass because you expected it to be quickly in heaven right now. Blessings don't come like we thought. They don't happen in our time frame. And we say, God, what are you doing? You can read many of the Psalms. David's crying out, Lord, how long will the wicked prosper? How long will this trial go on that I'm in? Frustration sets in, and we begin to doubt the living God. Amen. Let's talk about the evidence. The evidence is that Hannah had no children. Her husband's other wife, Peniah, had many children, and Peniah thought it was her job, her obligation, to laugh at her and curse her because she couldn't have any children. Of course, in that time, having no children was a curse, and they always blamed the woman. You can see that the man in this case, he was fruitful. He was able to have kids with his other wife. But the Lord had closed Hannah's womb. She was barren. She couldn't have kids. This is an opportunity for a miracle. When you're not seeing fruit, when you're at a dead end, when you're not getting that breakthrough, here's an opportunity for God to give you a miracle. Some, amen, will begin to mock you. Her rival provoked her severely in verse 6 to make her miserable because the Lord had closed school. 7, so it was year by year when they went up to the house of the Lord that she provoked her. Therefore she wept, and Hannah did not eat. Some get depressed when they have a situation and they eat like an elephant. They just keep shoving their face. That's why they're overweight many times. And they have health issues because of the stress they're going through. They're not seeing fruit. They're not able to handle things properly. Hannah did the exact opposite. And she began to starve herself. She would not eat. Her soul was vexed. Where is God? Where is the blessing? I want to remind you this morning that God sees your tears. He hears the cry of your heart. 2 Thessalonians 1, verses 6 and 7. Listen to this one. This is a good scripture. Well, we know firstly that God stores up your tears in heaven in a bottle. And he sees all the things that you've gone through, the pressures and the pain and the agony and the mockery. But listen to what God says about us. We don't need to harbor a grudge against people. We need to release them to God's judgment. Verse 6, since it is a righteous thing with God to repay those with tribulation, the people who trouble you, and to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. So God, I want you to know God is going to vindicate the righteous in his time, and he's going to exact a punishment upon them. Amen. For all those who trouble you and I. And thirdly, second best, being married is very good, but having children is even a more excellent blessing. Amen. She did have a husband, and she did not have children. She had something of a broken heart. When you have a broken heart, God takes notice of you. God sees you. God hears you. Amen. And he will not forget that. That's his promise. So, scripture teaches us that honoring God is what we need to be doing, even when he doesn't honor you seemingly. So we need to be faithful with church attendance. Some people choose to skip church when it seems like God has forgotten them and they can't pay their mortgage and they failed in this area and they turn their back on God. They say, God has abandoned me. God has forsook me. That means he left me in my greatest time of need. But Hannah, even with a closed womb, she still was found faithful. So it was year by year when she went up to the house of the Lord. She kept coming to church. She kept at it. She kept being faithful, faithful to pray and honor God. Verse 12, and it happened as she continued praying before the Lord, she never gave up. She never stopped praying, although she was still barren in that state of barrenness. She simply honors God by continuing to worship him. They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Hannah even brings a financial offering of thanks. We see that she is honoring God, and she gives to God the honor or the tithe, or not the tithe, but the offering that she made a vow to God when she was praying, and she said, God, if you'll give me a man child, if you'll give me a son. Verse 24, she was thankful. Now, when she had weaned the baby, Samuel, she took him up with her to the temple with three bulls, one ephah of flour and a skin of wine. And she brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh. And the child was young. She She also made it vow, a strict vow. She said, Lord, if you'll give me the baby, you can have him back. And he will become a priest and a prophet for you. She fulfills her agreement. She turned her child over to Eli the priest. Verse 28, therefore I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he lives, he shall be lent to the Lord. So she worshiped the Lord there when she brought him. She dropped him off. Can you imagine that? Any mothers in here? Or even a father? Or just imagine, put yourself. She went through all this labor and then she says, here you go, God. He's yours. She brings him back. She honored God with giving her son to God. Verse 11, she made a vow, this is earlier, O Lord of hosts, if you'll indeed look upon the affliction of your maidservant, remember me, and do not forget your maidservant, but I will give you the male child, I will give him to the Lord all the days of his life, and no razor shall come upon his head. That is kind of a religious sect, I think it's called the Nazarene vow. But when you come up to the altar at the end of a sermon, amen, you give God the opportunity to seal something inside of you that jumped out at you, like when you're reading your Bible and you're like, wow, I never saw it like that. Well, sometimes God is speaking to you through the sermon. It might not even be about the sermon. But if God draws you to the altar, you get on your knees and you begin to seek God and you ask God, seal that in my heart because that was special. I don't know what it was. There had to be one thing that brings you to the altar. That God has affected your soul somehow. And then coming to the altar gives you an opportunity to make a promise. Maybe you need to make some adjustments in your life or set some new goals and commitments, making future plans of heightening your devotion. Hannah also served her husband. She respected him. She did not mouth off to her husband when she asked him the question. Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? And why is your heart grieved? Am I not better to you than 10 sons? She could have said something very sharp and cutting there. Many of you are thinking what you wanted to say. She could have put him in his place, answered directly, but she holds her tongue. We all know what she wanted to say. Marriage is very good, but having children is excellent. Having a family would be wonderful. So she respected her husband. And lastly, she had a prayer life. Amen. The promise is that if you pray to God, he will answer you. If you seek God, you will find him. If you knock, the door will be opened. Her prayer was even misinterpreted by the priest, the aged priest who saw her in the altar and she was just moving her lips. And Eli tried to say she was drunk, moving her lips. There was nothing coming out. Boy, was he wrong. And he finds out the depth of her faith and makes a vow, makes a promise to her, you're going to have a baby this time next year. I'm going to see you again. He gives his approval, blessing, and voila, here comes a baby. So when you don't see what you want to see, we need to still be in prayer, be seeking God. The time element, I know it's painful. And it feels wrong, but we have to learn how to be patient to enjoy the promises fulfilled in our lives. Prayer is essential and will always help you through the dry times, the rough times, when you see nothing. And let's close by obtaining the blessing. And the outcomes for you and I is to become honored by God. God heard her prayer. She believed God. When the priest said, you're going to get pregnant, She went back to her house happy. She trusted God. She and her husband in 1 Samuel 1:19, then they rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord and returned and came back to their house in Ramah. And Elkanah knew his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. Then faith in God and trusting in His word and His promises always sets you and I up for success. When we believe Him, that means we trust Him. We're bringing honor to Him. And that's where the blessing flows into your life. And miracles will occur. Like this baby. A bona fide miracle. I'm being reminded of another miracle. There was a girl in our church. She and her husband couldn't have kids. The Lord has Dr. Womb. And an evangelist came in. He said, anybody here can't have babies? You want a baby? Raise your hand. They raised their hand. I'm going to pray for you. They brought her forward. They prayed for her. 9 months later, she had a baby. Was that a coincidence? Probably not. She obtained the blessing because she prayed and she believed. And she honored God. And God fulfilled her vow in verse 24. Now when she weaned him, she took him up with her, the three bulls, the ephah of flour, the skin of wine, brought him to the house of the Lord in Shiloh, and the child was young. Giving you children to God, amen, it's probably the hardest thing for any parent. Giving your talents to God, it can be very humbling and time-consuming and frustrating. I mean, I'm talking about playing music, or you know, maybe acting, or maybe you have some talents that you can help with the outreach or something coming up. Amen. Giving to God, honoring God with your talents can be very beneficial to a church. Amen. Giving of your finances to God. We see that she was faithful to pay the offering, and she, you know, you and I, when we give to God, God is a faithful God. He's going to make a way when it's dark. He's going to bring light to things. He's going to help you to go through the jungle of life and give you a machete and get you through there, man. He's going to make a way for you. Because why? You've been faithful to give. You've been faithful to pay your tithes. You've been faithful to put money aside for God whenever you got paid. You thought about the work. The work was in the forefront of your mind. Amen. When you give your heart to Jesus, that's honoring God. That means He's on your mind all the time. You give your mind to the things of heaven, spiritual things. Being spiritually minded always produces fruit, joy, love, peace, all the giftings of the Holy Spirit. Give your heart to Jesus. Amen. And you will obtain the blessing. And I'd also like to look, secondly, in obtaining that blessing, in Hannah's prophecy. Hannah's second prayer is prophetic. If you ever have time to read it, amen, and look at it and study it. The first prayer she had was, help! I want to get pregnant. But this prayer was like prophetic. She had dominion at this point. Amen. And God was moving through her life. She was experiencing His smile upon her. Amen. Let's look lastly at the results of her faithfulness, her prayer, having Samuel the prophet, that baby that she lent to the Lord. She gave him. She made him a little tunic, it says. And she would bring him up, you know, new sizes, I imagine, every year. But Samuel somehow began to learn how to listen to God. And God began to speak to him one night. And Samuel, the young, maybe he was a young boy at this time, I'm not sure, maybe a teenager. But he got out of his bed and he went to Eli the priest. He said, did you call me? And Eli said, no, go back to bed. So he goes back to bed and God speaks to him again. Samuel gets up. God's giving him words. God's giving him revelation. He goes to Eli. He says, did you call me? And he said, no. But I think God is talking to you. And God begins to speak to Samuel about the corruption of Eli and Eli's house, Eli's sons. And this is where God begins to move him. So we learn that because of Hannah's faithfulness, she was able to birth a baby who became very useful to God in the long run. Samuel has written two books in the Old Testament. Samuel is also responsible for anointing Saul and David, the first two kings in Israel. And also leading, you know, before that he was leading the troops and helping them to destroy the Philistines. She gives life to an awesome man of God. Samuel, heard by God. The Lord opened her womb, and thankfully she had six more children. The Lord visited Hannah, verse 21, so that she conceived and bore three sons and two daughters. And we also notice that Paniah, her husband's other wife, was not mentioned at all after that. But we see that when you and I, amen, honor God with our substance, our finances, our hearts, our prayers, our faithfulness to church, even when we're barren, amen, this is a great opportunity to exercise faith and to say to God, God, I believe you. What you promised is good. You're a good God, and I'm going to believe you for your timing and your fruitfulness, and I will hold on to the promise, and I'm not going to let anything shake me from that. And look what good can come out of your life. Look what promises will be realized, amen, and obtained in your life as you continue to be faithful to what God has promised you. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. No one's moving around. Thank the good Lord that my voice lasted this far. And no one's moving around, but we want to give you an opportunity to know Jesus. And Jesus himself did not receive any honor at all in this world. They wound up crucifying him. He was not honored. And you'll be honest, in your life, you've been honoring yourself. You've been honoring people, and you've been honoring this world system by living in sin and following the corruption that's all around you. But God is doing something interesting inside of you. Maybe even in the corona or the civil unrest that we're suffering through in this time in America, God is awakening people to his reality that truth is based on God and the Bible. And Jesus wants to minister. He wants to come to life inside of you also. You're not saved in here. You're not born again. You're not serving God. You're living in sin. And I want to give you an opportunity to get saved. That means you'll be made whole. And God will do a miracle working inside of you that you can be forgiven of your sin. Sin is the culprit. Sin is the problem in your life. It's not. You can't blame it on other people, what they've done to you. Blame it on your choices, your sin, the curse that you find yourself living in. And God will heal you. But you're going to have to understand that your sin is wicked and corrupt, but you can change your life. Amen. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. There's no remission of sin or removal of sin. And God will give you the miracle today. You're not saved. You want to become a Christian. You want to change in your life. And I want you to lift your hand right now as a sign to God. I'm not saved. I have no peace in my mind. I have anxiety fits. I'm depressed. I'm nervous. My marriage is just being destroyed. I have a habit. I have some addictions. I want to be free. I want you to lift your hand. Or maybe you're backslidden. You once knew Jesus and you decided to disrespect him, dishonor him by living in sin, going back into your sin lifestyle and choosing to rebel against God. Whether you've gone back to drugs or drinking or immorality, an old boyfriend shows up, or maybe you're just sick of fighting, you're sick of believing, you don't have an ability to see beyond what is in front of you. God wants to quicken those promises back to you, but you're backslidden. You've forgotten about God, and you have been wandering, and you are wayward, living your prodigal, wasted life is not producing anything good in your life. The cares of this life, maybe just having a family, maybe just working, the pressures of civil unrest and coronavirus, just suck the life out of you. There's no fruit in your life. You have no joy. You're not saved. Obviously not saved. We want to pray with you. If you're not saved or you're backslidden, I'd like you to lift your hand up as a sign before God. And maybe you lifted your hand online and you're home listening to this video, this stream. God wants to change your life. If you want to pray that prayer with me, we'll be willing to pray with you. And I need you to bow your head as an honor for God and pray this prayer with me. Close your eyes. Jesus, I am sorry for my sin. I am sorry that I have been dishonoring you and disrespecting you. And I want you to forgive me of my sins. Forgive me. Thank you for the cross, the crucifixion, the suffering that you went through. I ask you to heal my broken spirit. Wash me in your blood. Make me a new creation. Let the old pass away. And behold, let all things become new to me. I thank you for this day. I thank you for this prayer. And I repent of my choices to sin. And I repent of the old way of processing. Make me a new creation. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, either you're not saved or you were backslidden, and you believed and you feel that God is moving upon you, we want to know how you got saved. And shoot us a text or make a phone call. We would be glad to help you in your pursuit of honoring God. Let's sing this song with our brother. We're going to open up the altars if you want to talk to God for a quick minute. Amen. Or seal something in your heart. Make a vow to God. Don't let this altar call pass by. As we've learned from Hannah that her faithfulness and her vows have created something powerful. And she went to the temple. She bowed her knees. She called on God. And the priest said to her, yes, God heard your prayer and God's going to make it come to pass. Amen. Let's sing the song.
Thank you.
to worship. Lift up your hands and sing it out to Jesus. We want to bow down to you. We want to honor you. Say that you're my God. You're all together, Lord. All together. Let's worship God. Shake it out. Amen. Hallelujah. It's wonderful to be in God's house. Thank God that He follows through. Amen. He'll help us to obtain our destiny if we remain faithful. Amen. And honor Him in every area of our minds and our lives. And we'll be back tonight, 5:30 for prayer, 6:30 for our evening service. Amen. Brother Mark, you want to pray for us as we close?
God, we always look to you for strength, and we always try to overcome our adversities with you, as we are just lost at sea. But you show us the path, and you show us the way to righteousness, and you show us how we ourselves can improve, and how we can always forget and be cleansed of our sins, and how we can always become a new and better person. In Jesus' name.
Amen. The Lord bless you. Have a great day.